Penguin Random House Audio presents The Way of the Strangers, Encounters with the Islamic State. This is the author, Graeme Wood. Abu Huraira reported, "The Messenger of God, peace and blessings be upon him, said, 'Islam began as something strange, and it will return to being strange, so blessed are the strangers.'" Sahih Muslim. They were brought up in houses like his own. They were raised by parents like him. And so many were girls, girls whose political identity was total, who were no less aggressive and militant, no less drawn to armed action than the boys. There is something terrifyingly pure about their violence and the thirst for self-transformation. They renounce their roots to take as their models the revolutionaries whose conviction is enacted most ruthlessly. They manufacture, like unstoppable machines, the abhorrence that propels their steely idealism. Their rage is combustible. They are willing to do anything they can imagine to make history change. This was his daughter, and she was unknowable. This murderer is mine. Philip Roth, American Pastoral. A note on terminology. The war against the Islamic State is not primarily a war of words, though it is sometimes treated as one. To discredit and annoy the Islamic State, its enemies often insist on calling it by names such as ISIS, the so-called Islamic State, Daesh, and the un-Islamic State. This name-calling has yet to show any palpable effect. One supporter of the Islamic State told me, "We're happy to have you discussing whether to call us Daesh, ISIL, or ISIS. As long as you're talking about that and not about theology, politics, or military operations, we know you're not taking us seriously." Throughout this book, I refer to the Islamic State. Some readers will recoil at my decision to use the name the Islamic State calls itself. No writer has yet discovered neutral terms to describe the Islamic State or its beliefs, and my choice is not an endorsement. By calling it the Islamic State, I am no more supporting it than I am implying divine favor for Hezbollah when I use its name, which means the Party of God. The Islamic State is known by many names, all of which describe the same entity. They include the Islamic State in Iraq and the Levant, ISIL, the Islamic State in Iraq and Sham, ISIS, Daesh, and the Islamic State. The name Daesh is the Arabic acronym for Ad-Dawla al-Islamiyya fil Iraq wa Sham, which means the Islamic State in Iraq and Sham. Calling the entity Daesh in no way denies its claim to be an Islamic state. The term does, however, annoy the Islamic State's partisans. The Islamic State's preferred label is the Islamic State. Also acceptable to the Islamic State are Ad-Dawla, the state, and Al-Khilafa, the caliphate, led by a khalifa, caliph. They say that the entity known as ISIS, or ISIL, dissolved upon its declaration of a caliphate in June 2014, when it became the Islamic State. This book contains as little Arabic as possible. But discussion of the Islamic State is difficult without occasional resort to Arabic terms. Many non-Arab supporters of the Islamic State spice their conversation with Arabic, even when the Arabic words, such as Allah, God, and Dawla, state, have exact equivalents in their native languages. To reduce the burden on non-Arabic-speaking listeners, and to keep the flow of the original quotes, I have kept the Arabic and provided translations. Prologue. In November 2004, I took a job with a courier company in Iraq and moved to a patch of gravel next to the airport in Mosul. Two small temporary buildings served as office and living quarters. I shared them with two homesick Nepalese Gurkhas and a retired British soldier. Our planes flew in from Bahrain, and the four of us worked with a team of five Iraqis to unload and deliver their cargo. U.S. soldiers received care packages from family and equipment from far-off bases. Iraqis came to collect diesel engines, X-ray machines for the local hospital, and crate upon crate of untaxed Jordanian cigarettes for resale. At night, the Gurkhas ran up massive bills calling Nepal on our satellite phone, and the Brit watched movies, drank whiskey, and cleaned his boots and his gun. The occupation of Iraq, by then over a year old, was not yet at its most dangerous, and the insurgents' attacks were still journeyman efforts, not the masterpieces of mayhem they would become over the next 3 years. The U.S. military could secure the airport, but not the city around it. Insurgents regularly lobbed mortars and rockets, and the distant crunk of incoming fire served as a 5-second warning to dive into the small concrete bunker adjacent to my office and wait for the blast. A volley of inbound mortars could last seconds or an hour, and I sometimes heard helicopters buzzing off toward the authors of the attack and, with a rip of machine gun fire, killing them. By the third attack, I had begun prepping the bunker with a book and a flashlight so I'd never get caught dead or alive without reading material. During those long, cold evenings, huddled with the Gurkhas on a camp cot beneath 6 inches of concrete, I wondered about the man trying to kill us. He was probably my age, 25 or younger. Was he Iraqi, or a foreign adventurer like me? If the latter, how did he get here and why? I hardly knew why I had come to Mosul. Better jobs beckoned closer to home. So how could I expect to understand the motivations of this man I had never met? Did he also have better options? As he waited for the right time to drop a mortar into its tube, was he also cradling a paperback? This book grew out of curiosity about him. On December 21st, 2004, a suicide bomber infiltrated one of the airport's two cafeterias and blew up 22 Iraqis and Americans. I was eating lunch in the other cafeteria at the time. I was saved because my stomach grumbled in front of one mess tent and not another. When I learned the details of the attack, the bomber had weighed himself down with bolts and screws to multiply the shrapnel, my powers of empathy were taxed. I could imagine myself angry, even violent. But in imagining the physical sensation of murder, a vest heavy with a whole hardware store's worth of metal, I reached a limit and resigned myself to bafflement. Over the next decade, the insurgents changed, and so did I. I returned to Iraq as a journalist. The Gurkhas moved to Bahrain, and the Brit now guards the life of an ambassador in London. The last U.S. soldiers left Mosul in late 2011. My Iraqi friends say the Iraqi soldiers who replaced them stole and sold a large amount of the equipment the Americans left behind. With the Americans gone, the insurgents emerged from the shadows. A few years after the cafeteria bombing, members of the group responsible pledged fealty to the Islamic State of Iraq, ISI, the forerunner of the Islamic State in Iraq and Sham, ISIS. When I last visited Mosul, in August 2012, the city was nominally under the control of the Iraqi government, but people lived in fear of ISI, which they still called Al-Qaeda, a name the group itself hadn't used since 2006. ISI, Al-Qaeda, extorted shopkeepers. They killed and kidnapped. When we drove around, my friend Yasser asked me to slouch in my seat and remove my military-looking sunglasses because the streets had again become dangerous enough that I could be mistaken for a U.S. soldier or mercenary and kidnapped by Al-Qaeda or shot dead while we waited in traffic. On June 10, 2014, Al-Qaeda, now called ISIS, conquered Mosul with a force of between 500 and 1,000 men. The Iraqi army barely resisted. Mosul's population, mostly Sunni Arab and disdainful of the Shia-dominated government in Baghdad, greeted ISIS's Sunni fighters with trepidation, then terrified acquiescence. ISIS imposed Sharia law, and it ruled Mosul uncontested until the Iraqi army began its assault to retake the city in October 2016. The man I first imagined in 2004 was now in charge. To observe the conquest of Mosul by ISIS.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.